Hello dear students, welcome to the JEE-KCET and NEET class on the chapter Motion in a Straight Line. So let us have a look at the first question. The first question goes like this. It is, a particle travels half the distance of a straight journey with speed 6 meter per second and the remaining distance is covered with 2 meter per second for the first half time and remaining half time is covered with the speed 4 meter per second. The average speed of the particle is, so we have to find out average speed for this complete journey. So let me try to mark that the total journey is taken for the distance of AB. So I am just marking it like initial point is A, final is B. And the total distance from here till the end, let it be X. As we are being told that the distance is exactly in the half, so first half journey and second half journey, so the first half would be x by 2 and the second half would be x by 2. So the total journey is divided into two parts, that is half and half. So let me call the midpoint to be C. As we are told, the velocity in the first segment of the journey is 6 meter per second. So I'll call it as V1 is equal to 6 meter per second. And we are told that in the next segment, the time interval is equal but speeds are different, so the distance covered might not be same, the distance covered might be different. So greater the speed, larger the distance covered. With that notion I am trying to write this distances, but in terms of time both are taking the same amount of time. So here in the from C to B, first we know the velocity is given to be 2 meter per second, so I'll call it V2. V2 is 2 meter per second. And next, I would call it to be V3. V3 is 4 meter per second. And so now, let me try to solve this problem for the journey between C and B. So I would like to find out the average velocity for this journey so that I make the problem very simple. So average velocity in terms of velocities would be having this formula, that is V2 plus V3 divided by 2, that is initial velocity plus final velocity divided by 2 will give me average velocity, because in the beginning the velocity at C is V2 and at the ending the velocity at B is V3. So the answer for average velocity will be 2 plus 4 divided by 2 equals 3 meter per second. So here, moving ahead, what I would do next is just write down the velocity for the journey from C to B and solve out the problem for the complete journey. So as I got to know that the velocity for the journey C to B is 3 meter per second, so I'm going to retain it here and try to look after the further solution. So the average speed between C and B can be written as V is equal to 3 meter per second, and for the whole journey average speed, for the whole journey average speed can be written as V average is equal to, from the definition, x1 plus x2 plus so on divided by t1 plus t2. You might understood that there are only two portions, that is x1 and x2, so I am writing it in this manner. But here we don't know the value of t1 and t2, so let us figure it out using this knowledge. That is, I have to find out what's the value of t1 using the values of distance and velocity. You know that the relationship between time is time and distance and speed can be written like this. This time is equal to distance upon speed. So I can get here value to be x divided by 2 divided by 6. So thus this gives me x divided by 12. And here in the same way for the t2 you can find it and you would get the value to be x divided by 6. And once you substitute here you get it like this, that is x1 is x plus 2 x by 2 and x2 is also x by 2. So if you add both of them, you will get the value to be x. And t1 value, as you know it, it is x by 12 plus x by 6. This is equal to, so it becomes totally x now. Therefore, here I can try to take x by 6 common in both of them. So I would get it like x by 6 common. So the term that would remain would be 1 by 2 plus 1 here. So as I go ahead, I can cancel this x with this x. So I have it like this one. Since the 6 is in the denominator of denominator, goes to the numerator, and finally you are having 1 by 2 plus 1. So half plus 1 would give us 3 by 2. So that is 3 by 2. And if you try to rearrange them and try to figure it out what's the answer, then you get the value as 6 into 2 divided by 3. Cancel this with this one. I would get 2 here. So the final average velocity would be 4 meter per second. So the answer for this problem is option number 2. And we have it here. So let us move to the next problem and have a solution for it. So the next problem says that there is a car moving with a speed V on a straight road, which can be stopped after a distance D when you apply the brake. So the same car is moving with a speed 3V, three times initial velocity of the previous one. Then the ability of brake to retard, that means oppose the motion, becomes half. That is, retardation has become half this time. Then the car will stop after traveling how much distance. So to solve this problem, we should know the concept stopping distance formula. So let us try to understand it, then try to solve the problem. So let us take stopping distance concept. So stopping distance is actually denoted with ds, or else you can also denote it with d. So let us try to take an object which is trying to move with initial velocity u, and to stop this you are trying to apply an retardation, that is, you are trying to apply a brake. So if you try to apply a brake, the body comes to rest after certain distance. Assume that the distance covered by it is ds, or else you can see it as d. Since I am telling it stopping distance, I am calling it ds. You can call it as d also. So once it comes to rest, its final velocity becomes v equals to 0. So why did it come at rest? Because you are applying brake. Applying brake in the sense you are trying to retard it. That means your acceleration is opposite to the motion of the body. So acceleration direction is opposite to the initial velocity direction. So to find the value of stopping distance, you can use any one of the equation of motion. So the preferable one would be trying to write it in this manner, that is, v square minus u square equals to 2 into minus a. Why I'm writing minus a? Because this is retardation. Since the body is moving opposite to the applied acceleration, so the d, I'm going to take ds, I'm going to take it as d. And now my intention is to find out what's the value of ds, or an expression for it. So I would get it in this manner. Your v is 0, so it comes out to be 0, and you are having minus u square is equal to minus 2ad. And if you are writing an equation for d, you get the equation to be d is equal to u square divided by 2a. Now let us try to use this formula and fix this formula for our problem. So I am using this formula of stopping distance to solve the problem. Okay, so here in our case we are having two cases. In the first statement they have told us, that is, the initial velocity is assumed to be, let us take it as u1, is given to be v. And distance, let me call that distance as d1. d1 is given to be d, and we are having a retardation, that is a, which is negative. That is given to be a is equal to, I'm going to call it as a1, is equal to a itself. So therefore our formula for stopping distance can be written as d 1 is equal to d1 is equal to u1 square divided by 2a1. Next, in the same way for the second case, if I try to write it, for the second case if I write it, that would be for the next segment. So I have to write it like second case. So here the initial velocity is 3 times the previous one, and distance covered in the second case, we don't know it, we have to find out, and we know that retardation this time has got reduced, that is half the previous, the application of brake has become half. So therefore I can write d2 is equal to u2 square divided by 2a2. Right, now to solve this problem, let me try to divide d2 and d1. So if I try to divide d2 and d1, I would easily get the solution. So how I'm going to do that? So you can see it, we are going to do it in a simple way. That is, d2 divided by d1 will give me the equation to be u2 square divided by 2a2. I'm trying to write very systematically so that you follow the solution. So here you get this term, and finally substituting the respective values, just figure out what you get. So you are given u2 square, so u2 is 3v, so u2 square will be 9v square, and here in the denominator it would be 2a itself, because a2 is a a2 value is a by 2, so you get it 2a by 2, so 2 and 2 will get cancelled here, into here 2a itself you will get, because a1 value is a, and u1 square, so u1 is v, so it will be v square, and you can cancel this v square with this v square, a with this a, and finally you are remaining with the value of 18. Now therefore you can say that d2 is equal to 18 d1. And you know that d1 value is d itself, so the answer is 18d. So fourth option is right for this present problem. So now let us take the next problem. So next problem, it says that the velocity v of a particle moving along x-axis varies with its position. As v is equal to alpha root x, where alpha is constant, which of the following graph represents the variation of its acceleration a with time t? So we have to find out acceleration time graph for this present problem. So to do that, first of all, let me write the equation. So we are given that velocity is equal to alpha root x. Now to understand the concept, first of all, I have to have an equation which resembles this kind of equation. So to do that, first of all, I know the in the three equations which we know, that is three equations of motion which we know, only one equation has the relationship between final velocity or velocity and distance covered. So let me try to use that, and in that equation it also involves square of velocity. So if I square here, distance will lose the root. So squaring on both the sides, let me check out what will happen. I'm just using a hint, I don't know what's going to happen at the end, just we are trying to check it out. So squaring on both the sides, I would get v square is equal to alpha square x. Now if I check out carefully, here I feel that initial velocity might be 0. So if initial velocity is taken to be 0, so it would be appearing like v square minus 0 is equal to alpha square x. So by this you can see that this resembles one of our equation that we already know, that is v square equals, so v square minus u square equals 2ax. If you try to resemble these two, then you get to know that in this case initial velocity is 0 and our acceleration term is somewhere related to alpha. Then if I compare these two, I see that 2a is equal to alpha square. So acceleration is equal to alpha square divided by 2, and as they have given in the question that alpha is constant, so alpha square is constant and alpha square divided by 2 also will be a constant itself. So if it is constant, then it is not depending upon time. So that's why I say that this value or this graph here is the right one, because here the acceleration value remains constant.
Yes, so let us start with the fourth question. The fourth question says that velocity v of a body moving along a straight line varies with time, and it's given to be v equals 2 t square e to the power minus t. So v is in meter per second and t is in seconds. So find acceleration. We know that acceleration is a rate of change of velocity. So I can write a is equal to dv by dt, that is rate of change of velocity. So now, as we know differentiation, so using differentiation we can try to solve it very easily. So in the place of v, I'll substitute the value of v here. So it comes out to be differentiation of, that is d by dt of 2 t square e to the power minus t. So when we differentiate this, we see that 2 is constant, which can be taken out, and first we shall differentiate t square and get the differentiation of it. Till then I am going to retain e to the power minus t as it is. So differentiation of t square I am trying to do. Okay. So first term, that is first time I have differentiated this. Next, in the next one, I am going to bring 2 t square as a constant, and I am going to differentiate the term e to the power minus t. So as we know differentiation standard formulas, using those formulas if you try to differentiate it, you would get these obvious result, that is d by dx of x raised to n will be n into x raised to n minus 1. So in the place of x you are having t in our present problem, so using that we are going to write the first one. So here I'll get the value to be
2 into e to the power minus t, and differentiation of this one I'll get it like 2t, and here plus sign, and afterwards 2t square as it is, and differentiation of e to the power minus t. So we are going to take the standard formula for such a one. So if I am trying to differentiate e to the power minus x, then I'll get it as minus e to the power minus x. So substituting in the same manner, instead of x we are having t, so I would get this one with a minus sign. So therefore our value of a comes out to be, in short, it is 4 t e to the power minus t minus 2 t square e to the power minus t. So you have got this. Now, to find out at what time acceleration is 0, I have to substitute the value of a in this equation to be 0 and find out the value of a. So let's proceed now. Okay, so let us substitute value of a equals to 0. Okay, substitute a is equals to 0, that means acceleration is 0. So therefore our equation comes out to be 0 equals to, I'll try to take the terms which are common. Here I find 2t is common in both, and e to the power minus t. So I'm going to take those terms common, that is 2t e to the power minus t, and rest of the terms which are not common, let us keep them as they are. Should get here 2 and minus
here I will have only t. So therefore, I see that this term, as it is multiplied with that bracket, it can be sent on the other side. If you send it somewhere, it's of no use. So I'll be remained with the value 0 equals to 2 minus t. Now if you send the t on the other side, you get the value to be t is equal to 2, and that is 2 seconds. So option second is the right answer for the fourth question. Okay, let's go to the next problem now. So in this question number 5, the velocity v of a particle moving along x varies with its position, and it's shown with the graph. With this graph, we have to find out the relationship between acceleration and position, that is how acceleration varies with respect to the position. To do that, let us try to take the definition of acceleration, because in the graph there is nowhere time shown. There is velocity graph and it is versus position, velocity versus position graph. So let me try to take the definition of acceleration, and let me try to think what we can do further to simplify this or get the answer. So as we know, the definition of acceleration is rate of change of velocity, and we also know that velocity is a rate of change of position or rate of change of displacement. So now if I try to combine these, assume that I am trying to divide A and B. Just you might think why I am trying to do that. You will get to know. Reason is I don't want the time term. So if I try to write it in this manner, so it would easily get cancelled. So this delta t will cancel this delta t, and time is nowhere involved. That's superb. Now let us try to get this v on the other side. So I'll have A is equal to v into delta v by delta x. So I need to find out the value of this term, that is delta v by delta x, and what is it, and then finally find the value of v from this graph. If I do that and substitute here, I'll get the value of A in terms of position. So let's write. So as I know, delta v by delta x for this graph will come out to be nothing but a slope. It is a slope. So slope is nothing but m, and you can write it as delta v by delta x for this graph. And where is delta v? Delta v is here. So this is delta v. So delta v, so the velocity is changing from this point. Initially it was 4, finally it came out to be 0 because it's going in this direction. So from 4 it has gone to 0. So the value of delta v will come out to be 0 minus 4 I have to do, so it will be minus 4. So minus 4 here, and what's the value of delta x, which is over here? The value of delta x is 2 minus 0. So 2 minus 0 is 2, and finally I get the value of slope to be minus 2. Let us try to proceed with finding the value of v. So to find the value of v, let us try to use the equation of line and get the value of v. So since I know that this is along y-axis and this is along x-axis, and we know that here this is called as the intercept, that is intercept on the y-axis. So if I write the equation of line, so I can write y is equal to mx plus c. So on the y-axis I have v, so I'll replace y with v now. And in the place of m, I have minus 2 because I found the slope. Slope is nothing but minus 2 here. Minus 2 and x as it is, because it is the position. So x as it is, and plus c. C for our present case is intercept on y. So the line intercepts the y-axis at 4. So I'll retain the value of c as 4. So once I have this, I got the value of v here.
and I also have the value of delta V by delta X. So if I substitute them in this equation here, then I will get the value of A. So let me try to do that. So A is equal to V is minus 2x plus 4 into minus 2. So if you multiply this, minus 2 with minus 2 will give you plus 4x, minus 2 with plus 4 will give you minus 8. And you find that the option number 4 is the right answer for the fifth question. Moving to the next question now. Which of the following speed time graph is physically not possible? So beginning with the first one, whenever graph is given or any question is given, the MCQs, first of all try to eliminate the wrong options. So here, to start with, let us take the first option. So this is speed axis, this is time axis, and you know that in time axis you cannot come in reverse. So you have been till here and after that you cannot come back in time. So that's why I reject this graph, because we are coming back in time, which is not possible. And in the next case also it is not possible, because we have proceeded ahead in time and we are once again coming back because of this point. You can see this point is trying to show me that we have proceeded ahead and we are coming back in time, which is never possible. So for this, second option is also not the right answer. And for the third one, if you try to see that they are telling this is speed graph is given, and speed is always positive or zero, but it cannot be negative. But you see here that this has come in the negative axis, that's why this is also not possible. So all the three graphs are not possible, that's why I can say fourth option is correct for the sixth question. Let's move to the next question now. So here, velocity time graph for a particle moving along x-axis is shown in the figure. The corresponding position time graph is best represented by. So here velocity time graph is given. You have to find out its respective position time graph. So for this velocity time graph, if you think of acceleration time graph, then you see that for the first interval, for this one, from here till here, this segment, you see that if you plot the acceleration, you get the acceleration to be constant acceleration. Reason is the velocity is constantly increasing with corresponding equal time intervals. If you check that, you would see here. So constantly the velocity is increasing. So if constantly velocity is increasing, then the displacement covered in every interval of time will also get doubled or more than that. So it will not be the same distance what is covered in the first second. In the first second, you will cover less distance with less velocity. So with this velocity, you might cover less distance. As you go to the next second, the velocity is greater. So the distance covered will be more. In the next seconds, it will be much more compared to the previous. In the last second, it might be the highest. So the graph which represents the velocity time graph is obviously the first one. You can figure it out easily if you try to look at the expression of s equal to ut plus half at square. So here, once you observe, if you are trying to take the object starts from rest, because it is shown here, initial velocity is 0, then the displacement x will be equal to half at square. So as A is constant, 2 is also constant, that's why the displacement will be a parabolic kind of a curve, which is shown here. So it is quadratic. So quadratic with respect to what time? So you can see time here and here is the position. So that's why this curve is quadratic. So that's why it's abruptly increasing here. And then finally, in the next segment, you see that the velocity has become negative. Because of that, acceleration is negative. So that's why the position goes on trying to reduce, and finally you come back to the place where you begin. So the option which is right is the first one. Second one is not possible because there is a quadratic relationship between position and time. So this is not possible, and this is also not possible because it is not going to increase in this way. It is going to increase in this manner, and this is also not possible. So let us move to the next question. Question number 8. So the question number 8, it is being told speed time graph for a moving body along a straight line is shown in the figure. The average acceleration of the body may be, but so acceleration from 0 to 5 seconds, let me find it first. 0 to 5 seconds. So if you find acceleration from 0 to 5 seconds, then I will get A is equal to, so between this journey I am trying to ask from here till here. So if I try to take that, this is the delta V and this is delta T. So I would get to know that the value has changed. So the final velocity is 0, initial velocity is 20. You can see the final velocity here, you can see it is 0, so velocity has reduced. So 0 minus 20, so initially it was 20, finally it has become 0. And the time has increased in this manner, that is 5 minus 0. So now you get to know that acceleration for this journey is minus 4 meter per second square. The same way if you try to find out acceleration from 5 to 10 seconds, if you try to find it, then you would end up with the value A is equal to plus 4 meter per second, just by using the same technique what I have told previously. Now if you want to find out average acceleration, so average acceleration, if you find out for the whole journey average acceleration, then you know we find out average acceleration with total change in velocity, how much the velocity has changed from the initial point to final position. So if you take change in velocity, the object started from 20 meter per second and its final velocity is 20 meter per second, divided by the total time taken. So it is 10 minus 0, initial time is 0, final is 10 seconds. So if you check that, you have got the value as 0 meter per second square. Now you are having all the values which are possible in the through the graph, so that's why the right option is the fourth one, that is all of these can be the average acceleration of the body. So they have asked maybe, so we are telling can be. So it's possible that the body can have average acceleration as any one of them. So let's move to the next question. A ball is thrown upward with a speed 10 meter per second from the top of the tower, reaches the ground with a speed of 20 meter per second. So the height of the tower is, that we have to find out. So to solve this problem, what shall we do is, first of all, we'll try to describe the problem in detail. So I'm going to try to take that. The tower is given here. So let this be the tower. And let us take that height of the tower is h. So height of the tower is h. It is small h. So the object is thrown upwards from here. So if it is thrown upwards, so it is thrown with the initial velocity u. Okay, so it's thrown with the initial velocity u. So it is going in the upward direction. So after certain time, it will try to go to the maximum height. and at maximum height the velocity will be 0, and finally it will return back from there and it comes to the point where it had actually been thrown. So at this point when it reaches, you should note that the velocity what it had while it was going up will be the same velocity when it will be going downwards. The reason for this is, what work was done by the gravity against this when it was going upwards will be same when it will be coming downwards. So with what speed you had thrown upward, the same speed it will gain when it will be coming downward. So here the velocity will be u. So from here I have to find out what will be the height to the ground. So we already know it, it is the height of the tower at the edge. And it's being told that when the object hits the ground at the bottom, then its final velocity is recorded, that is v is equal to 20 meter per second. And its initial velocity is given, that is 10 meter per second. Using these quantities, we can try to solve the problem. So here we know that acceleration is involved, that is nothing but g, which is given to be in our problem as 10 meter per second square. And here the body is trying to go in the downward direction and acceleration due to gravity is also downward direction. That's why both of them are positive. So V is also I am taking positive, G is also I am taking positive and solving the problem. So here I will take the equation of motion, that is V square is equal to U square plus 2AX. So substituting the terms according to our present feasible problem, so I'll get it like v square is equal to u square plus 2gh. Here we have to find out the value of h, so I'll try to do some rearrangement with the equations and get them very easily here. So I'll try to take this u on the other side, so it becomes minus u square divided by, so this 2g will go in the denominator because it is multiplied with h. So the term which was added with h will become negative if it goes on the other side. The terms which are multiplied with h will become division if they go on the other side. So now substituting the respective values, you see that v value is 20, so if you square it you get 400, and u value is 10, if you square that you get it like 100, and then divided by 2 into 10, which is equal to h. If you try to simplify this, you get 300 divided by 20, and you can cancel this 0 with this, and finally you get the h value to be 15 meter. So the height of the tower is 15 meter. The right answer is here.
So here let us solve the question number 10, that is a ball is thrown from the top of the tower, so it covers the first half the distance of the tower in 10 seconds. So first half the distance is covered in 10 seconds and the next half is covered with what time, we don't know it. So I'm just marking it here. So first time that is it is covering, let me try to take it like t1 is equal to 10 seconds. Okay, so we also know that it is being dropped. Dropped means you should know that the velocity when it was dropped will be 0. You did not throw it, you just dropped it. And here if it is a half of the height of the tower, then you can clearly say that it is h by 2. If I try to say that the total height is h, then height of the half height would be h by 2. And here as you already know, acceleration due to gravity is acting, so a will be equal to g. G is given to be 10, so it is 10 meter per second square. So now here I'll try to figure out what would be the value of h using this one. So for this half the distance, let me try to apply the equation x equals to ut plus half at square. Ut plus half at square. So if you try to carefully observe, the x is nothing but the distance, that is half the height of the tower, that would be h by 2, and initial velocity is 0, so this terms will disappear, this term is going to disappear. So half as it is, and we know that acceleration due to gravity is 10, so a will become 10, and we know that time taken to complete the half the distance of the tower, half the height of the tower is 10, so 10 square is 100. So if you try to simplify it, you get the value of h to be 1000 meters. So height of the tower is 1000 meter. Now let us try to use the same idea to solve the complete problem. Here we already know height of the tower. So what is the height of the tower? Height of the tower is 1000. So I'll use this equation to get the time this time. So I'm using this equation. So total height of the tower is 1000, that is h. And what is u value? 0, because I'm starting from this point. And what is the time this time? So let us take that time is capital T this time. Okay. And half as it is, and a is already known, that will be nothing but g, and into capital T square, the total time taken for the ball to reach from the top to the bottom. So substituting their respective value, h value is 1000, and here it comes out to be 0, so I'll drop it. So 1 by 2 into 10 into T square. So this 10 can cancel 10 from here, so you get it to be 200, which is equal to T square. And if you try to take root on both the sides, you get to see that it is 100 into 2, so you can write it like 10 root 2, which is equal to T. So if you further simplify it, the value of root 2 is 1.41. so if you write it, then you have to multiply 1.41 with 10, so you get it to be 14.1 is equal to T. So here they have given the first option to be 14.14. So this is the right answer for the 10th question. So let's move to the next question now. So the next question is, a ball is projected vertically upwards. So this, it is thrown. Projected means it is thrown vertically upwards. It's thrown upwards. Its speed at half the maximum height is 20 meter per second. The maximum height attained by it. So they are saying us that it is being thrown upwards. So if I'm trying to take the diagram this way, it's thrown upwards, vertically upwards. I cannot draw exactly line beside it. Just I'm trying to show you that it's being thrown in this manner. So it was thrown from here. You don't know what is the initial velocity. So u is not known. And we know that exactly at the half the height, you know its velocity. So let me call this point to be like A. So if I call this position to be A, then velocity at this point is known to me. So that is given as 20. And you know that at maximum height, the velocity is 0. And you are being told that when it is thrown, that is exactly at half the maximum height. That means if the maximum height is h, if you are trying to take that, the total height is h, then half of the height will be h by 2. So you got to know that the height is h by 2, distance is h by 2 in this journey. Okay. And you know that initial velocity for this journey, okay, the upper half of the journey. And you know final velocity of this one. You have distance known. You also know that acceleration due to gravity is acting downwards, but the body is moving upwards. That means our A value this time will be minus G. So G is negative because the body is going upwards, and acceleration due to gravity is acting against it. So if I write the equation this time, I would get the equation to be V square minus U square is equal to 2AX equation I'm using. So here I would get the value as V square minus VA square, that is initial is VA this time, and 2 into A is minus G, negative G, and X is H by 2. That is only for this distance, because we are trying to take the initial and velocity for this h by 2 distance. So 2 and 2 will get cancelled, and our v square value is 0, so I'll have minus v a square is equal to minus g into h. So minus and minus will get cancelled, and if I substitute their respective values, what I have here, I can simply solve the problem very easily. So here I have v a square as a 20 square, and g, if I take it in the denominator, I'll get it to be 10, and that will be equal to h. and this comes out to be 400 divided by 10. Therefore, h value comes out to be 40 meters. So the right answer is option 4, and we are having the solution for this. Yes, thank you dear students, and we'll come up with a few more MCQ questions on competitive exams in the next video.